this video, we will digress a little and look at other applications for GAs such as in scheduling problems. Welcome back. We will look at genetic algorithms. We will continue from where we left off in the previous class. Let us look at some examples for how we can use genetic algorithms to estimate parameters and once again, you know, clarify all the fundamental concepts of how genetic algorithms work. We looked at a bunch of concepts yesterday, essentially those of what is a generation, what are individuals, or in fact they are also called chromosomes. Then the concept of what is a population, then mutation, crossover, selection, and so on. And how do we apply this to a practical problem, right? What is the practical problem that we have in on hand? We need to estimate, we have this sort of a cost function, E of theta is some something of this sort, right, where each of these xpi's are actually computed by integration, solving a bunch of differential equations that capture your mass action kinetics or Michaelis-Menten kinetics and so on. You need to find out this theta. What is theta? It is nothing but Vm1, Km1, then could be some K2. K3, alpha 5, whatever, all the parameters that describe your mathematical model, your biological system. It could be a particular binding affinity, it could be a rate constant, it could be an enzyme turnover number, whatever, it maximum rate of a reaction. So, all of these are your parameters. Now, you can think of sticking them into a vector of this sort. So, wherein, so this is like a bit vector. Where let us say you are contiguously putting in theta 1, theta 2, theta 3. So, this is basically theta 1, this is theta 2, this is theta 3, this could be theta, you know, some 8 and so on, right. How many other parameters are there in the system? Right? Let us say you have n parameters in the system and you just put them all next to each other. Now, this is the point, so this is the equivalent of the point that is being explored, right. From here, you make a mutation, you probably jump here. You make a crossover, you probably jump here. You make another mutation, you probably jump here, and so on, right. This is what it practically means. Of course, this is a point in n dimensional space, and here we are talking about single dimensions, but the idea is the same, right. So, you basically embed all your parameters . So, this is theta 1, theta 2 and so on. There are other ways to represent. So, in any genetic algorithm, if you just take a step back to see how genetic algorithms work, the biggest challenge is that of representation. So, let us pause and take a look at what are the other domains where genetic algorithms are used. So, genetic algorithms can be used in any domain where you have a somewhat difficult complex optimization problem, where basically you have given up on differentiating the cost function, or you have given up on gradient and you are relying on direct search alone, right. So, one classic example of this sort is scheduling. So, in fact, there are universities that use some genetic algorithms to schedule the final exam timetable, right, because different students have different courses that they are taking, And how do you make a final example timetable, final exam timetable that does not, you know, have too many exams for the same person on the same day, or even overlapping exams, right? So suppose you are taking course 1 and course 2, you can't have both courses having the final exam at the same time, right? So how do you resolve these clashes? So what you could do is, given a schedule, I can compute a score, how good that schedule is or how bad that schedule is, right? I might be able to look at the number of overlaps or, you know, whatever, things like that, right? But what would we even mean by computing a differential of this, or by trying to compute the gradient of this? It's not even a continuous variable, right? So it becomes very difficult. So given a schedule, you can compute a score. So how do you do this mutation and crossover? You need to somehow take one schedule, convert it to another schedule, or, you know, take two schedules and mix them up to form a third related schedule, right? This would be mutation and crossover. So your regular words, your regular concepts will end up having different meanings depending upon the problem in question. So what were the problems that we were looking at? What were the parameters that we were looking at? You were looking at So these were the concepts that we were looking at earlier. So what is a generation? I should probably call it evolutionary algorithm concepts, right? These concepts are shared across all flavors of evolutionary algorithms. We did look at least a few, right? So there is genetic algorithms, there are evolution strategies, there is genetic programming, so on and so forth. There are many variants, but in all of these cases, you need a recipe for each of these. What is a generation? What is an individual or a chromosome? What is a population? What is a mutation? How do you do crossovers? How do you do selection? How do you compute fitness? You need a method for each of these things. So let's look at scheduling. So in fact, another example I usually give is, how do you schedule the IPL, right? So you may want to schedule the IPLs in such a way that you do not have too many free matchless days for a particular team, right? You normally find in the IPL schedule that the same team might be playing on two consecutive days, but then they may not have a match for like 4-5 days. So I was trying to give you the example of IPL, right? So how do you schedule? So similarly, you'll be given a schedule. If you have a schedule, you can compute some sort of a score. But the thing is, how do you plan your representation? So let's say this is actually the same issue that one comes across when you solve the traveling salesperson problem. So the traveling salesperson problem, or any IPL scheduling problem, is something like, so maybe let's say there are 56 games. I want to order the games, right? So I maybe know which game has to, there has to be the game, and the city is not going to change, right? You need to have a particular game in a particular city, or you need to have a particular salesperson visit a particular house and make a particular delivery. How do you order it in such a way that something is economized? This is a classic scheduling or traveling salesperson problem. So now if I were to do a mutation here, I just can't change 2 to 5. I'll have 2 5s, which is not acceptable, right? Or I just can't take a copy of this vector and cross over with this, right? So let's say I cross over at this point, right? I would get a schedule 1, 2, 5. Okay, these are identical. So let's let's actually take a slightly different schedule. Let's say 5, 11, 16, 1, 8, something like that, right, and let 56 remain as is. So now the two schedules I'll get are 5, 11, 16, 11, 14, 56 and 1, 2, 5, 1, 8, 56. Again, this is not what you would consider a legal schedule, a valid schedule. So you need to essentially come up with some other equivalent operation for mutation and for crossover, right. What would be the equivalent operation? You will have to figure out. So maybe you just want to swap. You want to pick two matches and swap them. You want to pick two cities or pick two deliveries play points and swap them, right. So there are different things that you can do.
But again, won't that depend on the matches next day and the previous day? Because
why?
You said you can't give too much gap for a
team. No. So then we'll score that schedule. So you create, all you have to worry about is creating valid schedules, you know, having sensible representations. I hope you got an overview of what are all the possible applications for GAs through this video, and in the next video we will discuss the very important aspect of using GAs to solve optimization or parameter estimation problems, which involves how do you go about getting a useful representation that is tenable for running GAs on it. And we'll also look at some examples and an illustration.